So in the last video, we created this scatter diagram here. And in this video, we want to talk about looking at the nature of the relationship between the variables that you observe in a scatter diagram. And again, in this textbook, we're going to be primarily focused on linear relationships. So if we had, sorry, I'm trying to get my paper positioned here. If we had a set of data that we graphed, and this is looking at linear correlation. If we had a set of data that we graphed, and all of the data points fall perfectly on the same straight line, and if that straight line were to have a positive slope, this particular set of data would be said to have perfect positive linear correlation. Whoops. Okay, perfect positive linear correlation. Similarly, we could draw a line, a set of data that again all fall on the same straight line, but their line would have a negative slope, and that set of data would have perfect negative linear correlation. Okay. Now, for the most part, when we talk about real-world data, it's not going to follow a nice, perfect straight line like that. You just don't get data back from real-life scenarios that are that consistent. It doesn't happen. real-life data is messy. And so what we're going to be looking at is we're going to be looking at data sets where they're not going to follow a perfect straight line pattern. We might be looking at something more like that, where we can see there is something of a positive linear trend. We could almost even imagine, you know, superimposing a straight line in here that would try to capture the trend in the data as best as it could. And that does make sense to go ahead and model this with a linear model, a positive linear model. But one of the things that we might want to know is, to what extent are the x and y variables related? What is the strength and direction of the relationship between x and y? And if we don't quantify that numerically, if we just try to describe it, it's like, well, it's linear-ish. It's not a perfect linear correlation, but it's not no linear correlation. And if you resort to just English to describe this, it's not particularly helpful. We could ask people to quantify, you know, what do you think is the strength of the relationship between those two variables? But just asking people what they think, you're not likely to do a whole lot better. In a classroom of, say, 35 people, if I just said, what number would you place on the value for the strength of this relationship, we might get back 35 slightly different numbers. And so we need an actual method for quantifying the strength and direction of the linear correlation between two variables. And that value we call the correlation coefficient. And this is the correlation coefficient of the sample. There also is a population correlation coefficient. But since we'll be basing this on sample data, this is the correlation coefficient of the sample. It is symbolized by just the lowercase English letter r, so lowercase r. In this section, hopefully this won't get too confusing. Normally, we're used to thinking about lowercase letter r as the number of successes when we were dealing with binomial distributions. Here in chapter 9, lowercase letter r will always be referring to the correlation coefficient. We will no longer be talking about numbers of successes. Now, what the correlation coefficient does is that r measures the strength and direction of the linear relationship between x and y. Whoops, x and y. There we go. So it measures the strength and direction. A couple of interesting features of this measurement are, first is that R has no units. It is a unitless measurement, and it will always be between negative 1 and 1. So negative 1 is less than or equal to R is less than or equal to 1. So negative 1 to 1 inclusive. If we're calculating a correlation coefficient and it comes out to be exactly negative 1, that is a perfect negative linear correlation. Okay, our example back up here, these dots that lie all on the same negative sloping straight line, that would have an R value of negative 1. Perfect negative linear correlation. If we have a positive 1, by contrast, this endpoint, that is perfect positive linear correlation. Okay, so this first example here, all the points lying on the same positive straight line, that would have an R value equal to positive 1. Then the closer R values get to 0, that indicates less and less linear correlation, to the degree that if your R value ever equals 0, it's basically like saying there's no linear relationship between the two variables. So R approximately 0 means little to no linear relationship. Between the two variables. A couple of other interesting features of R. Positive R values imply that as x increases, y increases as well, or as x decreases, y decreases as well. Negative R values mean that as x increases, y tends to decrease. Okay, so not only does your R value measure the strength and direction of the linear relationship between the two variables, but it also tells you what tends to happen. How does one variable likely affect the other one? As one increases, does the other one tend to increase along with it, or does it tend to behave in the opposite direction? Does it tend to decrease? Also, interchanging explanatory and response variables does not change the value of R. So if I decide partway through my data analysis project to make my x variable actually my y variable and my y variable actually my x, that's not going to change the value of R. Again, R measures the strength and direction of the relationship. The strength and the direction should not change just because we've decided to name the variables differently. The strength and direction of the relationship between the two variables should be consistent, regardless of how we choose to label them. So R would remain unchanged there. Also, because R is a unitless measurement, changing the units of X and or Y will not change the value of R. So if, for example, I've been doing an entire data analysis project where my X variable was measured in inches, and partway through I decide, you know what, I want to do this in kind of more standard scientific units. I'm going to change everything maybe to centimeters instead of inches. That's not going to have an impact on the value of R. The strength and direction of that relationship will remain unchanged. You'll just have different units attached to your individual variable, but R will not be affected. Okay. Now, if you are interested in the development of the formula for computing R, or if you're interested in how to calculate R by hand, there's some great examples in your book that will lead you through that. You're more than welcome to take a look at them. I'm really going to focus on how to find your R value in the calculator. So we'll take a look at that. So let's go back to our set of data that we were looking at earlier. Okay, this data set that we had entered into the calculator, and we made this nice graph. Now here, first of all, I can tell before I even calculate an R value for this set of data, my R value should be negative because there is a negative trend to this data. As X increases from left to right, Y tends to decrease. So if I were to draw a line on top of this data that fits the data best, it would have a negative slope. So I'm expecting a negative R value. And in terms of how linear these data look, there does appear to be a curve to them a little bit, but there's not a whole lot of scatter. They all fall, you know, if you imagine a straight line going through there, relatively close to a straight line. So I'm also expecting an R value that should be pretty close toward negative 1 rather than closer to 0. Because again, R values close to 0 indicate that there's no linear relationship between the two variables. That's really not what we're seeing here. There is a certain degree of linear relationship between the two. So to do this on your calculator, the first thing that you need to do is to make sure that your diagnostics are turned on. If they're not turned on, your calculator will not display the value of R, even if you ask it to. So, the way to get to turn your diagnostics on, you want to press, and this is kind of weird, second, and then zero, that has the word catalog above it, and that will take you to your calculator's catalog. This is an alphabetical listing of everything that your calculator knows how to do. And we want to go to the D section of the catalog. So right now our alpha is turned on. So if we press this X to the negative 1 key that has the letter D above it, that will take us to the D section of the catalog. And I can see here I am now in the D's. And then you want to scroll down until you find diagnostic on. There's also a diagnostic off, so don't use that one. But when your arrow, your little arrow there, is to the left of diagnostic on, go ahead and press enter, and enter again, and it'll just say done. Now once you've done that, they will stay on, your diagnostics will remain on until you clear your RAM or remove your batteries. Okay, so once they're on, they're essentially on for good. You can go ahead and clear that off your main screen. And then assuming that you already have your data in here from what we did previously, okay, there's our data, and then what we will want to do to calculate the R value is press the stat key, press right to go to calculate, and then you want to use option 8 here that says linreg A plus BX. Okay, that's what we want to select. Now, this is actually going to tell us a lot of stuff, but we're only going to be working with the value of R in this particular video. You'll notice that at this point I've selected it and the calculator hasn't done anything yet. There's this blinking cursor. That's because the calculator needs to know which lists of data I would like it to perform a linear regression on. And I want it to use L1, so I'll press second 1, comma, second 2 for L2. Now this is really important when you're putting in this command. It should be linreg your X variable, comma, Y variable. You want it in that order, X and then Y. And once you have that entered in, press enter. And you get a bunch of stuff on this screen, but right now the only thing we're going to work with is R. And R is negative 0.95 about, which matches my prediction really well. I said we were going to have a negative R value because we were seeing a negative slope to the data, and also that the value should be a lot closer to negative 1 rather than 0 because there was very little scatter in the data around an imaginary straight line. Now, if we had plunked down this imaginary straight line and the data were scattered all over the place around it, there was a lot of spread to that data, this value would get a lot closer to zero rather than to one or negative one. And that's the idea with calculating the correlation coefficient. One thing to be careful with that your book does mention, and actually any book really should mention, is being wary of correlation and the notion that correlation is not causation. Whoops, correlation is not causation. Okay, so just because there is a high degree of correlation, or in other words, a relationship, a strong relationship, between two variables, it does not follow that one causes the other. Okay, just because there's a high degree of correlation between two variables, it does not follow that one causes the other. One example that I can give you is if you look at what year it is, if your x variable was year, and your Y variable was, let's say it was number of head injuries while skateboarding. If you were to plot year and number of head injuries while skateboarding, you will see that there is a very strong positive linear trend. Well, linear-ish, but there's a very strong positive trend between those two variables. But that doesn't mean that somehow what year it is causes there to be an increase in head injuries, right? That's not to say that that's what's going on here. What's really going on in this instance is that as the years go on, we get more and more people, so there's a larger population, and skateboarding over the years has become a lot more popular, so more people are engaging in it, therefore we have a lot more head injuries happening just because there's more people doing it, not somehow because the progression of time is actually causing more skateboarding injuries. Okay, so one of the many reasons that we can't jump from correlation to causation is because there can be what are called lurking variables. Okay, lurking variables are neither the x nor the y in the data that we collected. They're not the x variable that we collected the data about, and they're not the y variable that we collected the data about. But these variables nonetheless can have an effect on x and y and be partly responsible for the relationship between them. Anytime we try to take complex systems and boil them down to just two variables, we are oversimplifying what's going on. So even though there might be a very strong relationship between X and Y, and it might be a very linear relationship, that is not to say that that's because X is causing Y or Y is causing X. There could be some other variable out there that is responsible for increases or decreases in both X and Y, and is therefore having an effect on the nature of that relationship, but it's something that isn't quantified in the data that we collected. Okay, so we don't ever jump from a high correlation to say that there is a causal relationship between X and Y. We can talk about there being a relationship, we can talk about the strength and direction of that relationship, but we don't want to use causal terms to describe it.